So, welcome back, everyone. It's our pleasure to introduce Ilyas Tzadik, who will be telling us about the surprising power of LLL in noiseless inference. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Okay. Cool, let me start. So, hopefully the sound is okay. Yeah. Okay, so first of all, thank you very much for the invitation. Okay, I hear me. Is the sound okay?
Yeah.
Okay, sounds good to me. It's like, okay, in any case. Okay, so actually, it's the first talk I give with slides and formal after the pandemic, so it's even more of a pleasure. And let's see how this will go. So I will talk about the surprising power of letterless ANOVAs. Okay, so what is this algorithm? That's a lattice based algorithm. So it's a very famous algorithm in lattice theory, maybe less in inference, but I will talk of how it can be applied, I think surprisingly, in some noiseless inference problems and get some very nice results. This is a line of work I have been personally involved like 4 years now, and I'm very happy I can report some things. They started with conversations with David Gamarnik and Eric Kieseldag at MIT, later John Bruna and Minjai Sok at NYU, and also with Alex Wine, who's also here at Simons. Okay, so let me see what time this is. Okay, cool. So this will be a theory talk, but so let's make sure, you know, we're on the same page about some definitions here. So what is a more theoretical? I mean, and that's what I mean, obviously. Yeah. So let's see what is the noiseless inference here. Okay, it's a little bit So generally, what is inference or parametric inference? So we're receiving some samples or some parametric distribution, and there exists this hidden parameter theta star that we're trying to recover. And so we call this, you know, in at least this community, hidden structure sometimes, because it has a hidden structure. Okay, cool, so far so good. We can do this optimally, so with optimal resources. So like usually there's sort of this signal to noise ratio, as we say, which is like this number of samples or some measure of how strong the signal is in this noise environment usually. And you know, we want to do this optimally. And you know, there are two kind of main questions you can ask if you want to have optimal resources here. It's like, what can you do if you have no computational bound? So with computational bound resources, which is the classic statistical questions that lands in vanilla in the information theory world, which is, if I give you that many samples, can you recover this hidden structure? What is your power, period? And it's a very well-established field. There are still a lot of research, very nice questions, but it's a fairly established field. And then this other question that, like, essentially this semester at Simons is about, which is, if I bound your computational resources, what can you do? And that's a little bit more blurry, because like we do not have, like, for example, complexity theory in the classical sense, because these are usually average case, or like there is certain randomness in this generating process. So what we do, I mean, okay, there's some very nice of work, line of work, which tries to do reductions between these problems to measure their polynomial time hardness. But there's this other direction that essentially says, okay, I will just study some restricted class of efficient methods, and I will see how they perform. So like there is this idea, do the sum of squares hierarchy work well? Do low degree methods perform well? Do MCMC methods or greater than descent performs well? Do SQ methods perform well? Okay, and what we see a lot of times, and which is the topic of extreme interest, I would say, in this community, in this small community, is like there is a discrepancy. So like the SNR that our methods seem to be working seems to be much larger in many problems from the statistical ones. Okay, and we're trying to understand this. So I will try to tell you some new results in studying these gaps in the noiseless case. But let's see, is this motivated at all? So I will try to tell you a little bit of examples. Okay, tell you what noiseless inference is, at least in this setting, by examples. So to tell you my perspective, at least on this. So okay, let me tell you some classic example we're looking in this community, which is the spike matrix model. So what's the spike rank one spike matrix model, which is you have some hidden direction W you're trying to recover. And what happens is you observe a certain data, a certain matrix, which is this direction at some SNR, plus, let's say, Gaussian noise. Okay, and you're trying to see for which lambda can you actually recover this spike. Okay, so this is a noisy problem. So, and again, let me put like a little bit some comments here. So if you didn't have any noise here, the problem is trivial. Okay, so like you're observing the rank one spike, top eigenvector recovers the hidden spike. So it's necessarily kind of a noisy environment that you need to put some noise. And this has an implication in the algorithms we can use for this problem, that somehow if we decide to use an algorithm for this model, necessarily, if I inject a little bit of noise on the right on this matrix, which is of lower order than, let's say, the order of the noise that already exists, the algorithm will still work. So like the algorithm will still work by slightly changing this SNR. So somehow a necessary ingredient for any optimal algorithm for this model that we're trying to build will be a form of robustness in some form of noise. Okay, so good. I told you that there is necessary noise and there is this form of robustness. Cool. Let's go blurry the lines a little bit. So like there is this other model which is called phase retrieval that maybe many of you have heard here or maybe not, which is the thing, you know, it's a generalized linear model. So like you have this hidden structure, this hidden W again, and you're observing, you know, the Gaussian, let's say Gaussian, whatever, the linear projections of this W along some lines. You lose the sign, so there is some nonlinearity, and you add some noise. The way I said it's again a noisy model. Same thing. If you add a little bit of noise, you expect that nothing will change if it's like this. But one comment, if I make it noiseless, this makes sense now. So even if it's noiseless, it's not clear at all what's the optimal statistical guarantee, how many samples you need to recover. And also, it doesn't make, it's not immediate what algorithm you should be using. But now, comment with the previous comment I just made, if it's noiseless, it does not have this necessary robustness anymore. So like if I tell you, give me the optimal polynomial time algorithm for this noiseless problem, it's not necessary that if I add a little bit of noise into it on the right, the algorithm will adapt to it. It is not this much. Yeah. Not at all. It depends on the samples. It depends on the number of samples. So that's what I said. This question is also interesting. Like, yes. So how many samples you need? But what I want to make kind of clear, that at least to me, it was not clear maybe before I start thinking about these things, is that there is a big discrepancy in the noiseless versus noisy world to the extent of this robustness in the optimal polynomial time algorithm for this model. Okay, so like, because it does not necessarily adapt to this level of noise. Let me blur the lines a little bit more, which is a famous model that we care, at least in this community, which is the Plante-Click model. Okay, so the Plante-Click model is a natural, so first of all, what is the setting? So it's a graph structure. You observe a graph structure, you have n nodes. And then for any two of them, you flip a coin into probably half and you put the edge. And then you choose k of the vertices and you induce a click in it. So like you put every edge, if it doesn't exist, and you make it a click. So this has a notorious, let's say, for us computational statistical gap, because like you can recover the click when k is log n, but all the way up to root n, you would not know polynomial time algorithms for this. I claim that this model has some noiseless characteristics here. So what is the noiseless characteristic? Is that if I inject Bernoulli noise, at least IID into it, the model changes. It becomes the Plante dense subgraph problem, which is a different structure. It's like g n half. And in this case subset, you induce, you flip a one with probability p, which is less than one and bigger than half. So an optimal algorithm potential for the Plante-Click model, I mean, and here I'm talking, I don't have, so spoiler alert, I don't have any algorithm for the Plante-Click model, but nevertheless, I'm just at this level of communication. Like I'm saying that like the algorithm here does not need to solve this problem. Maybe it uses the rigidity of the Plante-Click and be able to enter this regime. Yes.
I think the separation you say is like the separation between algebraic and combinatorial algorithm versus optimization-based methods, which would typically work in noisy settings.
I agree, but like typically, because like maybe somebody could think of, is it necessarily any non-robust algorithm algebraic? I claim the other nature, the other direction is correct. Algebraic methods could be non-robust, that we will see, yeah. But yeah. Okay, and another connection actually, which I think even if you don't, you know, this analogy here does not convince you very much. Actually, Guy Tolman in personal communication, Guy Bresler, like watching there is deductions, that actually there is a deduction from the Plante-Click problem. It's actually work in progress, but there is a reduction to the noiseless phase retrieval problem with sparse W. So somehow, if you find a polynomial time algorithm that can enter the computational conjecture hard regime for the sparse phase retrieval prior, sparse phase retrieval problem, you could enter the Plante-Click regime. So somehow, and what I'm saying again, here, this does not need to adapt to this noise, to the extra noise. And okay, so what is this point trying to make? Is there is a little bit of a mismatch, in my opinion, which I'm open to discussion, of course, in what we try to understand noiseless inference. Yeah, please.
Making a both of these problems are noiseless inference, or maybe I'm misunderstanding.
So what is the both? What is the two?
The both the problem you're reducing from and the problem you're reducing to.
So yes. So what I said. Let me answer this. So like the Plante-Click model, I think it's a debate on what noiseless is, the definition of noiseless. in the way I define noise, which is ID Bernoulli, it's not tolerant to this noise because it changed the model. So I agree to this. But somebody could imagine some other channel, I don't know. So to avoid the kind of complication of defined noise, I'm saying to something which I think we will all agree that it's noiseless, there exists a reduction. So that's my claim. But yes, if you think of IID Bernoulli noise here, this does not tolerate this noise. The model changes under this noise, and of course, the model changes under Gaussian additive noise.
So presumably, varsity of W and varsity of K maybe have some relationship. Is that right?
They do. I do not know these reductions, though, so I shouldn't be saying about the work of, it's not my work. It's not my work. Okay, but what I want to make a point here is that, like, our community strives to understand these models as well without noise by analyzing the same class of algorithms. But this class of algorithms are actually naturally robust. So like the sum of squares hierarchy, the low degree methods, MCMC methods, gradient descent, SQ methods, they are robust to a certain amount of noise. So what I'm saying, conceivably, we could be missing the optimal algorithm for a lot of these models. And somebody can say, okay, but like we do not care. I mean, if it's noiseless, but that's what I was trying to motivate here. And like, if we care about the Plante-Cleek conjecture, we maybe should care about noiseless and non-robust optimal algorithms. Okay, so hopefully this conveys some message because I want to make this clear. So now let's see if I have anything to say about this though. Okay, so first of all, I want to tell you that this is not a new thing. I mean, okay, so if you are an expert in this area, you probably realize that I'm not saying something really new. And as Alex already pointed, there's some algebraic hiding here behind. So like, let's go to a famous model that actually is folklore that actually makes this message clear, which is the random Thrix-Orsat model. Okay, sorry about the mask. Okay, so like what happens in this noiseless version? You have x1 to xn, which are like some binary variables we're trying to recover. So this is the parameters we're trying to recover. And we're receiving NM equations. So we're trying to learn them by NM equations, which is like every time you query something and they give you like the sum of three of the coordinates. Okay, no noise. So if you are familiar with computational statistical graphs, you may have seen this picture all the time. So like if you just plot of what happens as you increase the number of M, the number of samples you have, this generic picture, not this specific one. So like, what happens if M is very small, if you have one sample, you cannot really infer. Somewhere around order N, it's believable that like this is the point where you can start recovering this hidden thing. And then, actually all our algorithms, the standard algorithms analyzed for this model, they start working around n to the 3 halves. Okay, so far so good, this is okay. And also we have certain sum of squares failure in the system. So like, okay, this is something that we would usually believe that like, okay, possibly there is hardness here, but the folklore thing is something else, that exactly because it's noiseless and these are linear equations, at this criticality where the problem becomes uniquely satisfiable, let's say this linear system, actually we can run Gaussian elimination and find this. Okay, so this kind of a folklore knowledge that like somehow for this model, the random Thrix-Orsat, this is actually not a represented picture. There is Gaussian elimination here. And what is the issue? Gaussian elimination is not robust. So if I add a little bit of noise here, that's how we usually solve this ambiguity. Like this is the actual real thing and this doesn't really matter. Okay, so what I want to say in this talk is that actually this, okay, usually at least how I've been taught about this thing is that this is a very pathological case. We should not think about it more because like, this is like linear equations. There is this worst case polynomial time algorithm, which is like, can kind of solve it in the at criticality, but you add a little noise and it's okay. So maybe what I want to say is that actually this is more generic in noiseless inference. And for some inference problems, we offer a standard polynomial time algorithmic framework, which can touch some, I would say, not many, but some noiseless inference models and close the gap. Okay, and it's not Gaussian elimination. So it's not Gaussian elimination, this algorithm, this polynomial time algorithm that can achieve information theoretical optimal sample complexity beyond the known methods. And this model, at least the work I've been involved, includes binary regression, phase retrieval, consigned neuron, continuous learning with errors, that's something in cryptography, and this planet vector in subspace or parallel hyperplanes or pancakes has been recently said. Okay, what is this algorithm? What is polynomial time algorithm framework? Actually, it uses some results from lattice-based theory. Lattice algorithmic theory. It employs some very, very powerful algorithmic scheme, according to my opinion, which is called Lenstra-Lenstra-Lovas algorithm, which what it does, it's a little bit, not as well used maybe in our community. Maybe some people disagree. I mean, that it essentially, you give it a lattice and tries to find short vectors in L2. So like it's a very powerful algorithm for finding short vectors on lattices. We will go in details about this, hopefully. Okay, and it's known in cryptography community to be non-robust. Okay, so it's kind of matches, it checks kind of, you know, what I was going to say. It's a non-robust algorithm. So indeed, we do not expect that this algorithm will succeed in the noisy versions of this model. Actually, it does not. And okay, and what is the technique? The technique is actually, I think, maybe interesting in its own right. I mean, it depends on your perspective. We do a reduction for all these models to subset sum. Okay, so subset sum is a worst case NP-hard problem. So why do we care about it? It's not linear equations that we have Gaussian elimination. But it has this fantastic characteristic, the subset sum, that's NP-hard, but there is some natural random input distributions that it's actually polynomial time solvable. So this is a breakthrough in the 80s, actually, that somehow has impacted a lot of the cryptographic community, that with LLL, Lagarus, Gliscon, Frisch, proved that like random subset sum is polynomial time solvable under certain input distributions. So like we connect these things with this. Okay. This is the method of the talk, essentially. Of course, details matter, so I will go into the details. What I'm going to do is tell you a little bit of what's gaps. Here we close. I will mess about binary regression, phase retrieval, and platinum vector subspace, high level, what we do, what is the result. I will not mention about these two models. It's more cryptographic nature, but actually I'm more than happy to talk about if you care. Then I will do a short detour about LLL and tell you a little bit about it, because I don't know, maybe you care about the details of what is this algorithm really doing. And then I want to describe basically how Lagarus, Gliscon, and Frisch solve this random subset of a problem and close. My ultimate goal is to tell you the reduction from phase retrieval to random subset sum. And conclude. Okay, so I have an ambitious goal. So, okay, but hopefully it will get somewhere here. Okay. Makes sense? Okay. So hopefully the binary regression, the reason I have it here is because it's the first example we noticed it. And it does have a subset sum nature in it. So you will probably, okay, hopefully you will see the subset sum nature in this model. The reduction is kind of clear. So, I will put sparse binary regression. Sparsity is not really needed here, but I put sparsity because of context, and Alex made a very nice also mention about some of these results. So, So what is the sparse binary regression model the way I define it? There exists this hidden vector W, which is sparse in the L0 sense. And it has values 0 and 1, let's say, or minus 1 and 0, and doesn't matter. So k of them are non-zero, and we do not know, of course, which k. And you receive samples in this following linear function. We get xi with standard Gaussian, and you see the projection of w in xi. And the goal is, you know, how many of them do you need to actually recover this hidden vector? Okay, and hopefully this is not a future sparsity will not matter here. So imagine more of a binary thing. And so what's this classic picture? I mean, of course, this has vast literature. Please do not see this as in any way exhaustive in this. I mean, just to give you an indication of what work I have been involved, for example, in this model, so in this noiseless problem, still our best algorithms, or at least the best algorithms I knew before this LLL application, were having this phase transition around K log D. So like, yeah. Yes. Yeah. So there is this K log D phase where RIP holds here, restricted isometry holds here, Lasso works, et cetera. And here you can say what's going on here in this, first of all, okay. On the other hand, think about it. How many measurements do you need to actually recover this hidden W? You actually just need one. Okay, so why do you need one measurement to recover this? It's actually a discrepancy between Xi being IID Gaussian, right? So the probability that there exists U, which is not W, that for one sample, it satisfies this thing, right? I mean, this is zero. So like almost surely they are rationally independent, the entries of IID Gaussian vector. I mean, this is a union bound argument, which is very simple. So somehow U binary, right? Or whatever, integer or, okay, whatever. So somehow, okay, so if you convince yourself that this is actually possible by brute force search along these things, you could be saying, okay, so this is the IT limit, what about here? Still, MCMC methods fail, Lasso fails, low degree methods fail, et cetera, et cetera. So this is kind of our classic rule of thumb about these regimes. LLL can do it. So LLL can find W in polynomial time with n equal to 1 with high probability. So this regime can close. And about the random sums and sum, I mean, you probably see already, right? So this is essentially like telling you, I give you IID Gaussian weights and some subset sums up to Y1. Can you find this random subset? Okay. So hopefully you can see, this is actually how we made the connection. I mean, this is the whole truth. Okay. Cool. Let's go something which is not subset sum in nature, or it doesn't seem like subset sum in nature, phase the pivot. Yeah, of course.
I'm not so familiar with.
I mean, I will explain, hopefully. Yeah.
I mean, do you actually have, I mean, is it solvent? Does it find a solution whenever it exists, or only, I mean, are you, how much do you need to use the fact that this is a spherical Gaussian here?
Yes. So we do not. Okay, so first of all, we find exactly W if this was the first question. So, and then there's
always find the W if there exists a solution.
So we exactly find W under some assumptions on the random generated process, because subset sum is not worst case solvable. So, like, we need some randomness in the input. But some, okay, I'm not sure what the state of the art would be now, but like at the moment, we needed IID continuous distribution, for example, not normal. But hopefully, okay, yeah, but that's the, yeah, but we need some randomness in the input. It's not it's not clear. It's not immediate. Sorry. Maybe it's immediate to some of you. It's not clear to me. It was not clear to me of how to do this. Yeah. Okay. Let me tell you a little bit of a problem which is not such a sum in nature. So W in the sphere, okay, so not discrete. So this was maybe I consider it like a big step in this direction. So W on the sphere, and then phase derivative subsets, which are projection of W in Xi, and you lose the sign, noiseless. Okay, how many do you need? So as I received the question, is it clear that, like, you know, at some point you will be able to recover if you lose the sign? So these are linear equations that somebody hides from you the sign of the inner product. Okay, so it's potentially algorithmically independent interest of, like, how do you even find, like, this W if you lose the sign? Okay, there's been a lot of work. Actually, D is the point where it becomes solvable. Like below, you know, below, of course, even without the sign, you cannot recover W. Right, and it's linear equations. Like you have no structure in W. And above it, actually, Candes company have like all these amazing SDPs that like work at order T samples. But recently there's been this work that actually analyzes famous statistical physiognomy with approximate mass passing, which actually pinpoint the constant exactly where NP fails. So like, and they conjecture actually that like naturally in this community, in this very nice work that includes also noisy case and another, like 1.12D is potentially the barrier for the algorithms. LLL can do it with D plus one samples. So if you give me one more sample than D, LLL can solve this. So can close this gap also, noiseless. Okay. Yeah. I cannot make, but this is a very good point. So at the technique level, where is the subset sum nature here? So the subset sum nature is that you do not know the signs, which are plus one and minus one. So there is a way to learn the signs by a subset sum problem. So this is, but if it's complex, you lose a whole cosine and sine. I do not see any lattice correspondence, but it would be very nice to. Yeah, this is, by the way, this analysis is also for a complex, so it's a, you know, it's a very nice paper independent. Yeah, I'm just saying this case, we can close. Okay, and finally, a recent paper. You may have heard this in this semester also if you're around Simos, which is this planted hyperplane or parallel pancakes, et cetera, which is like you have this W, again, a hidden direction, but what happens here? You receive samples which are from a Gaussian, that has the property that it looks like a Gaussian in every direction, but there is this hidden direction that it looks discrete. Okay, this is the formalization of this fact, that somehow you have this you sample things from a Gaussian that is really a standard Gaussian in every direction, but there exists this hidden direction that takes values plus one or minus one. Equivalently, you can think of it as a Gaussian clustering on mixture. So you see, you know, from these two mixtures, but I think it's less motivated like this. It's more motivated like, you know, it came up in the study of sum of squares for some reason, but like, sorry. The first people that analyzed actually is the Konokalas, Kane, and Stewart for SQ reasons, but nevertheless, like has connection with SOS. And nevertheless, I think it's an interesting model in its own right. somehow it has this hidden direction that like it has this discrete structure. Essentially, like you sample from two Gaussians that are like in low dimension like this and try to see. Okay, yeah, and then hopefully this is a model that makes sense. And okay, so what's the picture here? I'm missing actually a lot of literature also on this and in the previous phase of trivial, of course, model. But just to give an indication, around D is where the possibility becomes to see the planet structure. D square is when we have algorithms, which are very nice actually algorithms. And below it, we know that low degree methods fail. We heard about this in the first workshop. Some talk about this. And this is work by Alex and Cheng. And also we know that sum of squares fail in this regime. These are naturally robust algorithms. Again, I mentioned this, you know, to make the message clear. It's a naturally robust algorithm. So they're kind of solving the noisy version of this. And noise comes in these labels actually, but okay, this may diverge. So the point is LLL can do it again with D plus one samples. Okay, so we can close also this gap with D plus one samples. Okay. So hopefully I gave you a feeling. Now let's start to demystify things of like, you know, how can you do this? So I gave you a feeling about these three problems of what the result can do it. Okay, so now we'll start getting more technical because I need to explain a little bit like what this LLL is and how, you know, again, as I told you, so my goal is to, okay, let's make some goal here. My goal is to end up with telling you why this is solvable with D plus one samples. Oh, actually, you know something, I missed the reference that I wanted to make though. So, sorry about this, just a comment. After we came with this result in May, I think, we have been noticed 2 months later, a conversation with Daniel Xu from Colombia, they told us that actually they do have this result. So like they have a paper that applies LLL for a strictly harder problem than phase retrieval with no noise, which called correspondence retrieval, and they were able to obtain. So like I want to sort of say this for the matter of being correct here. It's a very non-well-cited paper, which I think is a misfortune because it's a very nice application of LLL. It's a very different proof from what we do. So it's good because, you know, in some way we have two proofs, so hopefully it's correct as a result. and also I think it's nice because, you know, kind of people have missed it. So I think it's, I wanted to sort of mention that, like there is, people have started noticing this connection, I think, from various angles, from different reasons with LLL. Okay, cool. So that's some disclaimer. Really? I have 10 minutes. Oh my God. Okay. Oh my God. Okay. That was a very ambitious plan. Okay. Okay. So I will do, I think I can have a escape from this. Okay. So, okay. What is a lattice? So a lattice is a lattice is the following form for us. You receive M vectors, which are in Z to the D, and a lattice spanned by B1 to BM is just only a linear combination of the vectors. Okay. So like if I give you 2 points here, it's just these blue lines. Okay, so that's a lattice. And what is LLL doing on the lattice? LLL is trying to solve this SVP, the shortest vector problem, which is tries to minimize delta to norm of X subject to X being in the lattice bumping non-zero. Okay, why is this, you know, it tries to solve a short vector in L2, which is non-zero. And why this is an interesting problem? I mean, like, you know, you can even think two dimensions, if it's V1 and V2, it takes some time to find the shortest vector. So LLL, first of all, okay, so quickly tell you, that's actually a hard problem. Like it's actually hard to approximate up to almost polynomial factors. It believes in the cryptography community for various reasons, it's even hard to approximate up to polynomial in the dimension factors. But LLL is this fantastic algorithm that can do this up to 2 to the D/2. So up to exponential factors, which may seem ridiculous, but nevertheless it's very powerful. And can do this in polynomial time in the dimension and the bits to describe the basis. Okay, so that's what LLL is doing. Finds a short vector, approximately. Yes, need to speed up. So like this is the gist of LLL. Now, what's going on with LLL, the approach by Lagares, Gluskin, and Fries? How did they solve random sub problems? Well, I mean, what they did is they said, okay, so they do a promise subset sum, which is the promise subset sum. So I need to specify you the weights. So what, right? So they receive certain weights that I put in the form of a regression setting on purpose. So you have D weights, and I'm telling you that like there is a Y that I reveal to you like you see, like for some hidden subset, you see the sum of this, and I ask you to recover the subset. So like, okay, so equivalently, you can say there is this binary vector that you know, it's an one sample regression with x1 and w, and they choose this weird distribution for x1, where x1, the weights are uniform in a superb large domain. Imagine 2^d². Okay, so d² random bits per weight. Okay, so if you do this, actually what they do is they construct a certain lattice from this that LLL works. And what does it mean to work? First of all, the shortest vector is w in this lattice. So if you are able to solve the shortest vector problem to the exact, you will find w. But also, you can never avoid that a lattice to have 2w or 3w, etc. So somehow what they say, it's like at a very, very large multiple up to 2^d/2, it's only this line. And then the next orthogonal direction to the lattice is outside this large ball. So because of this LLL, even approximately 2^d/2 of the shortest vector is a multiple of w, and LLL can find. So that's like the nutshell of like what they do. How do they do it? Well, they construct a certain matrix that I'm not going to tell us at the interest of time, which is it's really not what I do. It's not really thought that crazy if you see it a posteriori. It actually has appeared also in the lattice theory even before, that somehow you put in the first row the weights minus the response, you multiply with this large number, and then the identity, some construction. Okay, so details aside, that somehow has this property that every element, so for some tuning parameter m, all the elements which are short is a multiple of an one-to-one correspondence. So you need an extra dimension for 0w. Okay. And maybe just a comment then, since I don't have time, is that the way to prove this result is they really use, where do they use uniformity on the x1? They use the fact that, like, if you give me any linear map of x1, right? So imagine that these are ID uniform in a large domain. What's the probability that this any linear map of them takes any specific value? It's at most 2^-n, right? So if you give me any non-trivial linear map of uniform elements in a very large domain, they can not put a mass at any point in the domain which are more than 2^-n. So they're very anti-concentrated. Okay, so they didn't phrase it like this, but in the current world, we will say it like this. Okay, so, and then, okay, they tune the parameters. Actually, they can say that this ball is large enough, you can output some. Okay. Okay, so long story short, by using the anti-concentration on the x1 and the integrality of x1, which is very important for them, they are able to solve this one. Okay, good. I speed it up. Hopefully, people are still kind of getting what I'm trying to say. Okay, so so after we saw this and we were working on binary regression independent with David in 2017, we were like, come on, maybe we can do this with Gaussian instead of uniform in this super large domain. Like, can we solve with one sample like this thing if it's, this thing is binary, which is really a subset sum with Gaussian components? And we did this. So of course, in the paper, we did, like, you can say much more, but like, I think that's the gist. How do we do this in very high level terms? Gaussian or any continuous distribution, if you receive ID samples from them and you truncate the first d² bits, they look like random. So like the mass that the Gaussian assigns in small intervals, if it, the density it's bounded, which is, it cannot be like that big. So essentially we truncate and multiply, which we end up with certain this uniform essentially distribution. Okay, so like from this model, we truncate this thing to d² bits, hopefully, and multiply to go back to the freeze setting, but this introduces noise. But nevertheless, it's very, very small noise, so we're able to handle it. Okay, so this was kind of the very high level trick. Okay, I don't know how many people are following. So like this is a trick to go from the Gaussian setting, which I think is kind of clear. This is a random subset sum, first of all, and how to go to integers. This was the main difficulty. And you need to truncate very carefully and go back to it. There is introduced a lot of complication, but one of it is noise. And you can say, why can you do the same with W? Like if it's real, can you truncate and multiply? This actually introduced tremendous amount of noise, not that small. So somehow, natural, of course, right? It definitely is real. You cannot recover with one sample. But nevertheless, this is a mismatch. But nevertheless, yeah, if you're careful, thing, you can go back. Okay, and maybe I will actually end up with a phase trivial thing. So now let's go back to phase retrieval and see what does it have to, because I think it has one trick that I want to mention of how to extract the random subset sum from this. Okay, so we want to recover this thing. We want to solve this thing here with D plus one samples. Okay, so we have D plus one samples, which are of this form. These are yi, you lose the inner product, and you lose the sign of the inner product. I think by the way, this may be have interest independent algorithmically, right? So I tell you with D equations without the sign, you can do Gaussian elimination and find W. Now I'm telling you that if you lose the sign, you just need one more random equation. And in polynomial time, you can still find this W. I think maybe if you don't care about inference, maybe this is interesting algorithmically. And by the way, with D you cannot do it, but that's another information theory discussion. Okay, how do you do this? So the first step is the following. Yi look like xi dot w, but they have this this noise in the sense of like somebody has come and flipped it potentially. Okay, so somebody has come here and tell you, okay, you know, I actually flipped it. And you can imagine even the adversarial set that flipped it in any way they wanted. Okay. Okay. Okay, so I have these D plus one equations. They're not linear though, because I don't know W and I do not know epsilon I. There is a way to push W out of the game. And how to do it, okay, is the first step, because you have D plus one samples, and that's the importance, they're linearly dependent, the xi. So I can find lambda I of x by, you know, just Cramer rule that nullify the xi's. So the sum of lambda I xi is zero. I can always find, right? I mean, these are D plus one vectors in a d-dimensional space. So I can find a lambda is that is, and these are just determinant over determinant. I don't know, my Cramer's rule of the data. And then let's consider this quantity here. Okay, what is this quantity here? Is the sum of epsilon I, signs I don't know, times lambda I know from the data, and yi I know from the data. No W. Let's plug in yi. This is epsilon I dot times xi dot w, which kills the epsilon I because epsilon I squared now, but introduces the w. Epsilon I squared is one, so this is this. So this is this. So by doing this trick, you end up with equation, one equation, that you know everything except the epsilon i's. Okay, so let me say this again. So for some lambda i's you can find from the data, you can end up with some epsilon I lambda yi equals zero. Okay, so and that's a random subset sum. Because if I give you some numbers, these are my weights, and I tell you I multiply some of them with minus one, some of them with plus one, and I add them up to zero, it's equivalent with telling me which one are plus one, and I tell you that the sum of them in this unknown subset is half the total sum. Okay, of course, now you can say, okay, but this is not IID. These are nothing. I mean, these are like these weird things. These are non-integer, you cannot apply freeze. And even our paper, which says, which with David in 2018, these are non-IID. So you cannot have this nice mass is small at every D squared bits. But lambda is are not that terrible actually. Okay, low degrees of stretch. They're polynomials in the data. And because they're polynomials in the data, there's some very nice results from analysis that they use, they're anti-concentrated also. So by employing this thing, essentially you, okay, hiding of course work. I mean, you can make this one. Okay, so that's the reduction. Hopefully I convey you that there is a subset sum nature in phase retrieval. And okay, so let me say some comments here. First of all, I want to say that using robust algorithms prediction noiseless problems, that's something I learned by working on these problems. I think it's a little bit tricky. I mean, there are some wild algorithms out there that are not Gaussian elimination, that like, you know, they can still do stuff that we could not expect that algorithms can do. So when we make claims about polynomial time algorithms, we should maybe somehow add the robustness into it. I do not know what's the class of polynomial time robust algorithms, but yeah, I mean, I think there's something for our community to think about, maybe, or maybe not. It depends what you think. And okay, some question I have received after I communicated this work is like, okay, where was SQ in all these problems? Like I told you SOS, I told you low degree, I told you MCMC. Where is the SQ prediction? Somehow, none of these problems has an SQ lower bound that I described. And as opposed to actually, I have been tricked myself in this case, but actually it does not. And the reason is because exactly of this subset sum nature, you can do one query whether this subset sum is satisfied. It's like for the Plante clique, you can query if there is this large clique. So like with one query, there is this non-polynomial time SQ queries that essentially can detect between the null and the I do not have a formal theorem of this, just disclaimer, but that's my intuition. Like, that's why it's happening. That all of these reductions, all these problems, I do it by, you know, we do it by reducing and to subset sum. So maybe there is this discrete nature here. Okay. Another thing I have been asked is like, can we just do a formal relation with Gaussian elimination to have, you know, a little bit of more understanding, like Alex told me, right? You know, like, this is algebraic algorithms. This is the class we are afraid of, or like we should take into account when we do noiseless inference. I feel this like different. So subset sum is an NP-hard problem that somehow magically, to me at least, in average cases becomes polytime for appropriate input distributions, that I do not know also exactly what's the generic class that it becomes. Gaussian elimination is worst case polytime. So I think that like somehow there is something different here in like somehow it employs some average case easiness that, yeah, I do not know how far this can go. Maybe there is this other average case easy problem that, you know, we can use as a trick. And yeah, I do not know the formal connection. I think that will be nice, somehow a class of this. And of course, I think the open problem is clear, right? How generic is this class of noiseless models that LL can enter? I have no idea. I mean, how, you know, this via the subset sum trick, maybe some other trick, and or other. And of course, you know, the big question, I think, because I know I believe in, okay, some people also believe in the Plantin-Kiel conjecture, but of course, I mean, I do not think that LL can do this, but you know, it will be very nice to see where it blocks, where does it get blocked if you introduce sparsity. None of the models I have worked on, we were able to encode sparsity in the lattice. So like, I do not know how to use sparsity in the lattice, but yeah, I mean, this brings I think an important question here in the Plantin-Kiel conjecture. Maybe the Plantin-Dense subgraph is safer, I don't know, as a bet, but yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Elias. Yeah. Any questions?
Thanks, really pretty. I'm curious, how robust is this to numerical or precision, or I'm not sure if robustness is the right word you want to use this, but I mean, you presumably need pretty good numerical precision for this to be exact. I'm curious if you can quantify that, and also how does that compare with information, theoretic information precision you need to get it with just D?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So let me mention some things. So, first of all, we do sweat a bit and we get a finite precision algorithm. So like we do the truncation carefully and we do work with bits because we were worried about the same thing, that somehow we were losing something or we're doing some super mistake when we apply. So LLL to terminate requires integer numbers. So for this, we truncate and carefully we use the termination of LLL so to do not lose the bit complexity. But the main gist maybe is, okay, so this is what the one question. What was?
Can you quantify? Okay, maybe one is, can you quantify this? The second is, I mean, I know, is it like to the level that's actually implementable?
Yes, I think it's implementable. So,
and the third is, how does it compare to information theoretic accuracy? Because also information theoretically, you need some, you know, enough accuracy. But I'm curious.
Yeah. So maybe let me do this in phase trivial. I think it's a good example. So in phase trivial, actually, what happens is this. So we have these equations. I tell you that I can deduce some subset sum relation. This subset sum relation, I can quantify with every probability exactly the size because it's one bit. And then it's all that matters is solving Gaussian elimination. So like, which is, yeah, so it's all the, it's all the precision that Gaussian elimination can give you.
That's good.
Yeah, I mean, fair. But somehow I'm saying this epsilon I, we can learn exactly. And in polynomial time and in every bit complexity, but somehow, yes, it all matters is how much can you invert linear system. I do not know the information theoretic aspect of this. Yeah, maybe we can talk. I do not know the information theoretic aspect.
Any questions? So if not, let's thank Elias again.
Thank you very much.
And get some good research done this afternoon.